All right, Chris Barnes, how's it going?
Good, man. How you doing?
I'm good. You know, just checking out your resume and everything that you sent over, man. You did some pretty good blogging about Chicago.
Appreciate it, man. Appreciate it. It was fun. It's fun.
Yeah, definitely. Well, we'll get to know you a little bit better. And where'd you grow up at?
I grew up in Chicago, of course, on the east side. So southeast side of Chicago, Woodlawn, Gresham area.
What are like the streets?
I'ma say east side, man. You know what? I just gotta be me, bro. I'ma say east side, Stony the Water. That's where I grew up at.
Okay, so the east side is kind of like below the south side, right? It's like, it's below it, but to the east?
Well, the east is water. So you got, the right. Closer to the water you get, that's where you at over east. So when we was growing up, it was state to the lake. State divides the highway or whatnot. But you know, as we got in certain positions, we kind of closed it off. So we just say Stony to the Water, east side.
Okay.
Sorry, y'all. Stony to Water.
And so what was it like for you growing up there?
Man, I ain't gonna lie. It was fun, but it was barbaric as hell, man. Like, I can't lie to you. It was a fun place to be, but it was dangerous at the same time. But when you in the environment, you don't really think about it, if that make any sense. But it was treacherous.
What are some of your earliest memories you have growing up there?
Let me see. My earliest memory. All right, I'm gonna tell you the first thing that pop up on my mind. I had to be like 5 years old. You know what I'm saying? I was a jit, you know what I'm saying? I was a shorty. So I remember my uncle walking up to the porch. It's like early in the morning, 7 or 8. So he talking to the older guys. And I look at his palms and they was like green. So I'm like, he like, what's up? I'm like, man, why your palms green? He like, I've been counting money all night. So like, that was the environment that like I seen growing up. It was just like a lot of like, shit was unreal, man. I ain't gonna lie to you, it was unreal.
Okay. And how did you avoid getting involved in gangs?
You know what? It's just standard. When you're around 13 years old, you got a choice to make. You know what I'm saying? You can like go all in, or you can just kind of do you. So I ain't gonna lie, man. It was a program called College First. So every summer I do the College First programs, and then I'll play baseball after school. So I was busy. You know what I'm saying? Like, I tried to be as busy as much as possible. So just avoiding idle time. You get what I'm saying?
I take it you grew up with a lot of people who were in the streets.
Yeah. You know, it's like we was all in the streets, bro. Cause you know, did you hear Donda?
I haven't heard it yet.
Ye said it the best, man. He said, how you gonna say we was in the same car, but you telling me to stay in my own lane? So it's like, we all struggled together. You know what I'm saying? We slept on the floor together. So it's like, some people made certain decisions and some people didn't, if that make any sense. So everybody was in the streets, but people wasn't in the streets full time, if that made any sense. Like, it wasn't until like 15, 16, where people got full time in that street activity.
Did you feel a lot of pressure to get involved in gangs and everything?
Honestly, no, man. Not at all. No, because... No, man, like, everybody... I was cool. Everybody was cool. Like, you know, like, I was cool with the brothers. I was cool with the folks. So, like, it wasn't... It was like, okay, before the internet, you really ain't know. You don't know what was going on and who was with who. You get what I'm saying? Like, you ain't know what was going on. So... I could be in a car with you, and you could be in a bunch of shit. But if you don't tell me, I never know. It wasn't until late in life where, like, you leave the hood, and then you start hearing things. You get what I'm saying? So, like, it was a big mystery, man. So, like, you might hoop with somebody, or you might mess around and mess somebody downtown, but you don't know what the extracurricular activities was. So... It was just kind of like we all had common interests, you know what I'm saying? So, like, I did music, people do music, you know, so it wasn't like you got to get down with this, if that made any sense. I never had pressure to get down with the get down.
Okay, and What do you think was some of the craziest things you've seen growing up in that environment?
Man, the craziest thing I've seen, and it was nuts, cause like 15 to like 21, like I caught a blessing, you know what I'm saying? Like I caught a legal blessing. I always been a hustler. Like, man, when I was 25, I cashed out for like 75,000 legally. You get what I'm saying? Like really hustling, bro, like a legit. I was making so much money, people thought I was selling drugs. So when I came back to the hood, you know, I blew all the money. I came back to the hood, I had my girl with me and whatnot. And I heard like shots let off. Oh, I was on the nine. I heard I was on 79th and Mirror, 7824. I heard some shots rang out, da 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 da. My lady at the time, she from Milwaukee. So she like, what's going on? I'm like, don't worry about it, it's fireworks. Whole time, I know it ain't fireworks. So I come out, I pop out the back. And then I just walk, I walk towards the alley. And I just seen a dead kid, bro. Real talk. Rest in peace, Archie, man. I didn't even know Archie's name until I started doing the blog. But the sight, that image just never left my head, man. I was like, damn. He was just laying on the ground like a dog on the street, man. Just, but he a human being. You get what I'm saying? But it's like, they left him over there like stretched out like an animal. And that shit like, it really messed my head up because I had friends that I lost. You get what I'm saying? Like, and I seen them in caskets, but it's different when you just see that body like fresh on the street, bro. I ain't trying to be graphic, but that's really what it is. Like, damn, this motherfucker was alive 2 seconds ago. Now he just dead in the alley. Shit, it's crazy, man. I ain't gonna even lie to you. That shit, it still bothers me to this day just seeing that shit. I never knew Shorty, but it still bothered me though. Like,
you were the first one to get there.
I wasn't the first one to get there. Like, people were out. So, you know what I'm saying? People were outside already. I just popped outside to see what was going on. And, like, the whole block was out there. Like, the whole block. And the vibe of the block, man, like, I never felt this before. And I never felt it after. Like, everybody felt the same way, bro. It was like, we lost something. You get what I'm saying? Like, that shit was crazy, bro. Like, rest in peace, that young man, bro. Like, that shit was, it really messed my head up, bro. Like, everybody on the block was like, damn, we just lost this, bro. Like, that shit was messed up.
Yeah, rest in peace to dude. Man, so that was your first time seeing something like that?
Yeah, seeing it, like, from gun violence, I should say. Like, you know what I'm saying? Just seeing people get hit by cars and shit like that, but, like.
How did that affect you?
Man, it really didn't, if that made any sense, you know, because you got to look both ways crossing the street, you know? But it's like, when you get stalked down and you just don't see it coming, it's just, I don't know, man, it's hard to explain, but you don't look both ways crossing the street, you're going to get hit by a car. You know what I'm saying? Like,
so you guys didn't know each other, but you guys grew up in the same area, I take it.
Man, I had just moved around the area. You get what I'm saying? Like, I had just moved around the nine. Like, I was fresh back in the hood. So, he was a shorty. You know what I'm saying? I was 25, he had to be like 14. So, like, I'm not hanging around with, he was a kid to me, you know what I'm saying? So, the first time I seen him was on the ground, like, dead. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm like, damn. Shit get treacherous over there.
What was high school like for you?
Freshman year was treacherous, man. Freshman year was treacherous. You know what I'm saying? But after freshman year, it was smooth sailing. But freshman year was a different beast.
Well, what was going on your freshman year?
It's like, it's the first time everybody from every different hood is in one area. And everybody jockeying for a position of power, trying to be like Billy Badass, you know what I'm saying? So it was, you had Dro City, Gyro City, Paxtown, Pockettown, East End. You had all these sets. And then you had people from out west in the hundreds. Then you had people from Inglewood. So it was everybody in this one set. every gang, like every gang in this one school. So you have to learn to, you have to really learn to get along with these different sets. You would never talk to these people ever in life, but you hanging out with, you in the same class with somebody for like 6 to 8 months. You know, he necessarily may be from the opposite block that your people not cool with, but you all are eventually gonna form some type of relationship. So freshman year was a, it was like filling everybody out. And then sophomore to senior year was cool.
Did you go to school with anybody that became popular or famous?
Yeah, King Louie. I went to school with King Louie.
Okay.
And that's the only person I could think of off top. But, you know, High Park had a lot of, like, King Louie, Dro, they started drill. And then, like, the people under us, like, they just, they made it mainstream. So King Louie was in that, he was in that thing.
Okay. And was there a lot of drama going on during, in the early years? Did a lot of kids get kicked out of school?
Yeah, freshman year, I ain't gonna lie, a lot of kids got kicked out of school freshman year. So all the guys got kicked out freshman year, you know. So they, yeah, a lot of people got kicked out, man. A lot of, they kicked out a lot of people freshman year. But you know, they'll still hang outside the schools and whatnot.
Okay, and what was the rest of high school like for you?
Man, you know what, high school, bro, I seen so much early, like I seen a lot early. So, like I say, my uncles and I was thumbing through money. Like everybody was thumbing through money. So when I got to high school and I seen the guys, you know, they was making cash, bro. But it was like, man, if I can't make X amount of money, I don't wanna, you know, get involved in illegal activities. So man, honestly, I just found things to do for the rest of high school, man. Found a job, you know what I'm saying? Like found a girlfriend, got a job, got busy. Stayed out the way, man, because it was just vicious, you know. So I just kind of did my thing, man. Just stayed out of the bullshit.
What was your first job?
The first job I ever had, it was Nordstrom. I worked Nordstrom on Michigan Avenue, so I was doing stock. And I did that.
How old were you?
Like 15.
15. Wow, yeah. They let you have a job that young? Okay.
Yeah, either I lied on my application or it was something around that. It was 15. My cousin plugged me with the job. So she plugged me with the job. And it was, you know, it was really good money at the time, man. You know, made a good $10.50 an hour. And during the time, you know, it was good money for a 15-year-old, man. Then one of the store managers saw me. She seen how I was, like, operating. And she was like, hey, I want you to hit the sales floor. So I hit the sales floor. And after that, I ain't gonna lie, man, I started cashing out on their ass. Man, I was making like $80,000 selling t-shirts, bro. Like, so I went from like, so it was kind of hard to dabble in the streets when I was like touching like grown man money at such a young age. Cause like I had to hustle from the hood. So I'm like, damn, niggas selling these dime bags and I'm over here selling t-shirts. Man, fuck this, I'm just finna sell a t-shirt. So I just got selling t-shirts and jeans and shit. And I wound up being like top five in the company.
Damn, that's what's up. Yeah, how long did you work there for?
And I did that for like 12 plus years, because I started so young. So I probably damn near did it 15. No, probably.
Oh, okay, so you worked there a long time.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so after you graduate high school and you're still working there and everything.
I was trying to do the college thing, because everybody in my around me at Nordstrom was like, you know, they was in college. So I'm like, all right, I'm gonna do the college thing. But I talked to a professor, I talked to my guidance counselor, and I'm like, well, if I stay in school, because it was hard to do both. And I'm like, well, if I go get my degree, how much money you think I can make? And she was like, well, you'll be coming out making like $40,000. And I laughed. I'm like, well, this is what I'm making, selling t-shirts. You know what I'm saying? Because they tell you you're going to get this degree and you think you're going to be some big, important person. I'm like, this is what I'm making, selling t-shirts. Like, she ain't believe me. So that was the last time I walked in college. I left and never came back.
What was the point? You was making so much money then.
Yeah, I'm paying y'all. They showed me how to make money. I already know how to get it.
Yeah, I hear that. Okay, and so what do you do after high school?
So after high school was where it got like a little gray at. because you got a lot of time, man. So, like, I'm 19 years old. I moved to Jeffrey Manor.
Where?
I moved to Jeffrey Manor. It's an area called Jeffrey Manor. Okay. So I moved, they call it the Manor. I moved to the Manor. You know, I got like, I got my first car, I put the car on 22s, me and the guys hanging out. So like, I had a foot in the streets because I had free time to like hang out in the streets. Like my baseball dreams was done. I already mastered the art of selling. So like, I didn't have to focus on that as much. So like, I'd just be partying. You know, you party in your 20s, and when you party and when you got resources people won't, and then the other people got resources you won't, you learn to just combine your resources and have a good time. So we was painting the city red, man. The street guys and the backpackers, they had to get along when I was around, you know? So it was pretty dope, man. I did that. And then around 2012, when the drill scene popped off, like, it was deeper than music, because it was literally like sex, money, murder, you know what I'm saying? So like 2012, my brother passed, my cousin passed, and my sister passed. They like back to back in 3 weeks.
Is this from gang violence or just from other stuff?
Sister lifestyle, street lifestyle choices. Cousin, he got shot in his back, and my brother, he had like a seizure in his sleep. So,
oh, you know, wow.
Yeah, they was running rampant in the streets, man, so they was like living a certain life. And I just thought one day, I'm like, man, do I really want to like sell t-shirts all my life? So I just left that job and just started doing other things, man. And people looked at me like I was crazy. They're like, why would you leave that job? Like, it's 401k benefits, retirement. Like, I just didn't want to do it anymore. You know what I'm saying? Like, it wasn't about the money. It was just like, I just didn't want to be in that line of service, man. Like, I was humbled enough, you know?
Yeah. And at one point you start blogging.
Yes.
How'd you start? What made you want to get into blogging?
Quarantine hit. I got bored because of quarantine. So I started doing like a political blog. Then Doug died. And when Doug died, I made a rest in peace to FBG Doug post. And I did that post and it got like 40,000 views in a day. So people start asking me about Chicago, and that's how I got into like the Chicago blogging.
Okay, so you only been blogging a little more than a year.
Yeah, about a year. Yeah.
Okay, and that was your first blog that you did, and it blew up. Okay, and you decided to keep going.
Yeah.
You've been influenced by Chicago. I think take it you've been keeping up with the drill movement this whole time.
Yeah, I was listening to the drill music like before Doug passed, and before it got weird, you know what I'm saying? So I was into the music, you know, I was into the music.
What was some other things you started blogging about?
So I started off with the rest in peace FBG Duck, and then from there people wanted to know more about the neighborhood, so I did the block walkthroughs of Old Block, and then I did the death sites of like the Chicago legends people wanted to know about so bad. And that took off.
Yeah, it's your biggest video. I tried to go to Old Block HK Death Site, and this is what happened.
Yes.
Okay, can you talk about that video a little bit?
Yeah, man, I had this, it was this plan I had, where like, you know what I'm saying, they said, give the people what they want. Somebody said, hey man, you from Chicago, go to where HK died. I'm like, all right, you know what I'm saying, I'll go. So I filmed it for like 20 seconds. I'm like, well, this is where HK died. And when I thought about it, I rapped one of their ops lyrics because I was so used to, when I thought about the death site, I thought about the song. So when I did I said the line, and it's treacherous over there, and I'm like, man, let me film this and get out of there because I'm not from over there, you get what I'm saying? So before I turned the camera off, some told me like, nah, you might want to clear that up. So I'm like, look, y'all, I'm not laughing at dude for pump faking. It happens, I done it, rest in peace, O Block HK. And that shit just took off. It just took off.
Okay.
And then that's when I realized people was fascinated with Old Block.
You've been to Old Block a few times?
Yeah.
Okay. You went by yourself?
Oh, of course. Yeah, of course. You got to go solo dolo, man. It's better to go solo.
It's better to go solo. Then they won't think you're up to nothing if you walk with a bunch of dudes or with somebody.
I don't for me personally, I just like doing things on my own, you know what I'm saying? Either way I go, like, if you look suspicious, they gonna get on your ass, you know? I just figure I just go by myself because I can only be responsible for what I do. Like, I don't wanna bring nobody around just in case something happens, because if you think like that, something gonna happen. So I don't think it's necessary to, like, bring security to a block.
Did you run into anybody, talk to anybody or anything?
Going? Just regular people, man, just regular everyday people.
Okay. How long would it take O Block to walk to 63rd? You know what? I think I've watched that video before.
That's crazy. You seen that video?
I did. I did. I, it was a while ago that I seen it, but okay. Talk to me about that. We'll give you the idea for that one.
A guy from London was like, "Hey, Chris, you should walk from Tuckerville to O Block." And I'm like, "Man, you crazy. I'm not finna walk from Tuckerville to O Block. That shit, it's a red zone." You get what I'm saying? I'm like, "I'm not doing that shit." But then I got to thinking about it, and I'm like, well, you made this walk 100 times anyway. So I just made the walk.
Oh, so you used to walking around there?
Yeah. My pop's from 63rd.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it's just, you grew up in the environment, man. So my pops grew up on 63rd. So we used to go to the rink, to the route. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was normal back in the day, but things got different in 2012.
Gotcha, okay. So take me through it. What happens? You walk through, everything's cool?
Yeah, man. The objective of, I build suspense for the videos, but in actuality, like, nobody cares. It's me. You get what I'm saying? I don't advise other people doing it because they don't know them. You get what I'm saying? Like, I'm from the area, so I got a familiar face. I don't advise people doing block walkthroughs, though. I ain't gonna lie to you, because... You know what? Let me stop.
Someone's gonna watch this and get a dumb idea and think it's a good idea.
Let me stop capping. Do not do the block walkthroughs, because it's somebody gonna pop out, and when you least expect it. So it's not a good idea. I don't suggest them block walkthroughs, man. Check in with the people first.
Well, you know they got that King Von mural now that people are driving by, stopping, taking pictures. What do you think about that?
I honestly think it's a beautiful thing, man. Like, when it comes to O Block, O Block is now such a tourist attraction. I think it's cool that people walking by, taking pictures and doing things of that nature. O Block is a little bit more contained because they got the gates, but any other hood is just, it's the wild, wild west. You know what I'm saying? I think it's cool though. I like it.
You interviewed KTS Dre.
Yes. I interviewed KTS Dre.
Okay. How'd that come about?
When you from certain places, like, okay, I've been in Chicago all my life, so everybody
is just a phone call. I mean, everyone.
Okay.
How can I put this, man?
You just knew some people, or?
Okay, I gotta be real, because I want to get this off my chest. Look, rest in peace, Dre. I love Dre. Dre was a great person, man. Dre is a Chicago legend. You know what I'm saying? Like, Dre beefs were not and are not my beefs. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'ma always have love for Dre. You know what I'm saying? Just based off, you know, like, where he from and, like, who he got love for. You know, so, like, Dre always showed love to, like, you know, he always showed love to Rico, Corey. And he was a good dude, man. So since he dig up the people I love, I got no choice but to love, bro. You know, that don't mean I'm out here sliding for Drake. You get what I'm saying? Like, that's not my role. I don't know anything about none of that. You know? But Dre was a good dude, man. Dre was a good dude.
So you guys link up and you do the interview?
Yes.
How's that turn out?
Man, you know what? It was one of them things when I did the interview. Nobody knew the importance of the interview, but the interview had to happen, man, because it was his last interview. It was like his last words. It was his final words before he left the earth. You know what I'm saying? It's like he got everything he wanted to get off his chest. And a lot of people wanted me to ask him a lot of questions about KTS Von, because his brother at the time was way bigger than him. Rest in peace, KTS Von. But I wanted the people to know who Dre was. You get what I'm saying? So, like, people, I didn't ask the popular questions, but now looking back, I asked the questions that was necessary. You know, like, I might write a book about it.
Okay. Dope, dope. Did you know KTS Von? Did you know his brother also?
Man, I did not know KTS Von, man. I did not. I probably seen him before he had the fives. I probably seen it before he had like the fives cracked on his face. Cause I don't think I ever ran into Cutthroat Von. You know, I don't think so. But I never told anybody this. But I actually ran into their father. I never told nobody this, but I ran into Dre's father. Me and Dre's father had a conversation. It's weird, and I didn't know until after Dre passed. I'm like, wait a minute, I had a conversation with Duke.
Oh, so you guys talked?
We had like a
and you didn't even know. You didn't know that was his dad at the time.
I had no idea that was his dad at the time. We had an interesting conversation. Even before I met Drake, his conversation always stuck out to me.
Okay.
Chicago is a very segregated town, and even within the hoods, it's segregated. You know what I'm saying? Like, black people in Chicago are segregated. You know what I'm saying? Like, everybody is against each other. Like, I'm not here to pick sides. You know what I'm saying? I'm here to blog and to bring journalism to the Chicago drill culture. You know what I'm saying? So a lot of times, if like people try to tug me here, try to tug me there, like, no, I'm doing me, I'm doing my own thing, you know? So I don't want anybody classifying me as a gang member or somebody from the streets or something like that, you know what I'm saying? Like, I got love for everybody, you know? I done lost people on every side, so I ain't, you know what I'm saying? I'm picking a side, it's my side, you know what I'm saying? If ain't nobody riding on my side, I'm cool with that. Rest in peace, man. Long live Drake, man, long live Corey, man, and, man, shout out to ATL.
That's what's up, man. You know, I love what you're doing. You know, I when I go through, I've actually watched some of your videos. You know, you do a good job. You know, you're out here now in Cali living, though, right?
Yeah, man, Cali living.
Well, hopefully you go back out there and start doing some more blogging. And people really like it. I mean, a lot of your videos got really good amount of views.
People love the drill, man. I wish they love the drill as much as the music. Speaking of music, I do gotta say one thing. Shout out to Prince Drake and 100K Track Management. They put me on the intro of Prince Dre's debut album, Woodline. And it's only right because I'm a Woodline baby. So I appreciate them doing that. They didn't have to do that. So I appreciate it. And they got Moo-Wop on the album, DQ on the album, Hot Boy on the album, Fredo Bang on the album, and Prince Dre. It's a great album. It's really a classic album. I wish people would start paying attention to the music or the drama.
Well, that's what's up, man. I appreciate you coming through, sharing your story.
Thank you.
Definitely.